بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد. الحمد لله. By the grace of Almighty Allah, I have come to the fourth session of knowledge management. If you are not familiar with my channel or about introduction of knowledge management, then you can watch my three previous sessional videos on the topic of knowledge management. Also, please subscribe to my channel. Spread the light. Now we shall analyze and discuss the next stage of knowledge management process, which is the development of core knowledge framework. In today's session, I shall explore about the core knowledge introduction about the three phases of developing a core knowledge framework. And in today's video, I shall discuss about the initial and first phase of managing core knowledge in detail. Let's start with the introduction. Knowledge management ensures that important corporate knowledge is identified, accessed, shared, and retained for future reference and reuse. Implicit in this process is the need to identify and clarify which knowledge is important to the knowledge organizational good. The kitchen sink approach, where all the organizational knowledge is captured and made accessible to others, can reduce the capacity to access useful knowledge. This is the reason that many intranets are less useful than they might be. They lack rigor and structure. A key driver of the introduction of knowledge management is the recognition of the benefits of linking the business strategy to intellectual capital in the organization. Firms operating in volatile, evolving markets with new or untried products are often particularly keen to optimize their productivity and cross-functional interactions. The KMS, which means the knowledge management system, can bring individual knowledge, distributed localized knowledge and documented sources into a cohesive and easily retrieved organizational strategy through the content management system, the abbreviation of which is CMS. Content management system is increasingly recognized as a vital element of knowledge management. A key purpose of the CMS to link knowledge sources to all the relevant knowledge users, regardless of their level of appointment, location, or role. The development of a successful CMS requires two levels of activity. Number one is the valued knowledge needs to be identified and categorized so that it may be managed. And number two, the knowledge needs to be managed and maintained effectively. This session covers the first of the two levels relating to content management, that of identifying and promoting the development of important knowledge sources. Look on the core knowledge. Many organizations fail to clarify that knowledge is important to their business. This can reduce employees' capacity, opportunity, or desire to share their professional knowledge. A goal of knowledge management then is to develop a knowledge strategy which is important knowledge so that employees are aware of the need to manage it appropriately as both distributor and user. The CMS offers the capacity to identify, structure, and manage knowledge which is important to organizational outcomes so that it may be linked to the business strategy and ensure valued knowledge is accessed by appropriate users at the right time to suit their needs. Core knowledge is strategic or operational knowledge that contributes to essential organizational processes or outcomes. It is distinguished from other forms of organizational knowledge in that way that it supports the essential focus and activities of the business. Number two, it has long-term value to organizational activities. Number three, it enables higher performance in core activities for the organization. Number four, it justifies the cost of capture and management of that knowledge. Lastly, it minimizes duplicated, misinformed, or redundant efforts on the part of knowledge workers. The CMS offers an effective mechanism for identifying and unifying the many different expert sources of knowledge held in the community in comprehensive, efficient, and responsive manner. However, the process of clarifying what is core knowledge can be challenging and time-consuming when first initiated. A content management system provides the opportunity to build a comprehensive and responsive system that brings expert organizational system and explicit knowledge together in a cohesive and accessible repository. Investment in a CMS operates at a number of levels. Resources are needed to develop and maintain the technical aspects of the system, such as the human-computer interface and the content management activities. Substantial costs to individuals can occur while registering contacts, for example, through attaching metadata and authorship details, assigning descriptors, and verification of author details and security management. The development of a core knowledge framework is an important component of a building an effective repository. The graphical picture of the three phases of managing core knowledge is represented as shown in this slide. Let's go through this figure step by step. Phase 1 has been known as clarifying core knowledge scope, which has further subheadings like identify core business and its knowledge requirements, define the knowledge domain, review knowledge capabilities. Phase 2 is define core knowledge parameters, which has further subheadings of define core knowledge and develop the core knowledge policies. Last and the third phase of this code process is to develop the core knowledge structure, which has the categories of map, core knowledge, and build the knowledge repository. In this way, core knowledge is managed step by step. Let's start this session with the first phase. Clarifying the knowledge, core knowledge scope explores the type of knowledge and the way they are used in the organization. Three aspects of organizational activities are examined. First, core business, that is the organizational activities and priorities that need to be supported by accurate and comprehensive knowledge, is identified. An understanding of the relationship between available knowledge and core business is an important basis for in subsequent content management. Secondly, knowledge domain is identified, that is, knowledge is described in terms of business areas which are supported and actively encouraged. Third is, using this specification of the scope of the desired core knowledge, the capacity of staff to share and generate that knowledge is reviewed. Thus, this first phase reviews the nature and scope of the core knowledge that should be captured and shared by the knowledge community. The parameters identified through phase 1 are described as definitions and policy in phase 2. Defining the core knowledge parameters sets the boundaries of the core knowledge which should support the business activities. Without this formalization of the nature of core knowledge, the management of the CMS, which means content management system, will be poor. This helps with their contribution to that process and their use of the system for their own knowledge creation and development. The core knowledge parameters need to be sufficiently flexible to accommodate changing organizational directions and priorities. Following phase 2, a variety of core knowledge structures may be designed in phase 3. Core knowledge structures are systems and processes that help with mapping and organizing an organization's core knowledge. They may include map of knowledge held in the community and structure system, which help with categorizing, indexing, and labeling that knowledge. The development of the knowledge repository enables effective management of core knowledge by drawing all relevant sources into a single searchable process. Viewers, many knowledge organizations fail to recognize the importance of clarifying their core knowledge scope. They allow the business to evolve and expand into a range of areas and specialties which may or may not be of value. Clarifying the nature and scope of core knowledge highlights the major strengths which contribute to the business outcomes. Most importantly, the process builds stronger organizational awareness of what business the organization seeks to be encouraged, what areas of activity are most strongly supported, and what capabilities should be evident and shared across that work community. Overall, the main question to be answered in this first page is, what knowledge should be available to support the core business? Now we will discuss the subheadings of the first phase, which is the clarifying the core knowledge scope. Identify core business and its knowledge requirements. Each organization is unique. Various factors influence how the organization operates. User requirements, the local competition, and the people in an organization often influence the particular way the key business processes evolve. This identification of these business priorities and directions enables the core knowledge requirement to be clearly framed. Each organization relies on different compositions of the core knowledge, reflecting its historical, functional, and strategic work characteristics. For example, the many types of engineering firms, those operates in Australia. Some focus on specialist services to a specific sector, such as health services. Others support primary resource development, such as mining activities. Some are mainly product focused, seeking to develop useful tools and equipment. These firms see their core knowledge in different ways. Consequently, it is important to consider what elements of the business activities are essential to the ongoing well-being of the organization. A useful starting point then is to review the knowledge base, which is important to the organization and its business activities. For example, the analysis might focus on where staffs are concentrated, where business growth is occurring, and the trends in the business sector. The current strategic plan, the perspective of the key stakeholders, and the plans for change and development. A review by Siemens, for example, found that the knowledge portfolio developed by its specialists often differed significantly from the corporation business strategy focus. The next important factor of the phase 1 is to define the knowledge domain. Once the core business and its knowledge requirements are defined, it is possible to clarify the scope of the knowledge that should be identified and managed. The first step offers some guidance, but it remains fairly general in its approach. The second step in clarifying knowledge, core knowledge, is to investigate more specifically the areas of knowledge that are most likely to be encouraged across the organizational community. Each organization operates within a prescribed knowledge domain. That is the area of knowledge that the core business strategy of the organization. The knowledge domain may have two levels. Number one, those elements that all members should share and use as basic fulfillment of work environment. Number two, those which are strategic priorities to be developed and supported over a time. Information on knowledge domain can be drawn from job description and specifications, projects and sectional plans, accountability frameworks and performance indicators, and other sources. This provides an insight into the knowledge competence that might need to be explored or accessed in the knowledge community. For example, the core business of general medical practice is to provide patients with appropriate support and guidance on medical issues. The knowledge domain might therefore relate to GP medical practice and theory, patient case management, specialist doctors available for referral, customer relation management, business management, and administration. Different staff could contribute in different ways to this knowledge domain, but it reflects the broad scope of knowledge which forms the basis of core business. In some organizations, the monitoring of the changing knowledge domain has generated a new position, that of domain manager. The next important factor of the phase 1 is to review knowledge capabilities. Knowledge management is also affected by employees' capabilities and requirements. In order to build an effective knowledge management, it is necessary to examine what it is that employees either know or need to know. There are many ways to review these capabilities. Interviews with supervisors and employees on how their work can also identify ways the work is being adapted to accommodate limited knowledge. Some sample work tasks can also be done and analyzed to identify the key behaviors and strategies used. This identification of a significant knowledge supply network is an important initial framing of potential sources for others. Thus, the analysis of employees' capabilities need to be operate over a number of levels and should identify desired capabilities, valuable sources or knowledge, and demonstrable capabilities and knowledge practices. At this stage, the key questions to be answered are, what do our employees really know? What should they know? And how can they gain this knowledge? This state seeks to clarify the required knowledge, the real knowledge capabilities of employees, and the sources of expertise that are or might be accessed by others. Factors to be considered in this choice include the level of trust and honesty in the organization, the degree to which learning and sharing is currently encouraged, and the abilities of staff to undertake the audit. This is a major activity and needs to be properly resourced as it guides the overall core knowledge strategy. For example, ShareNet Assessment illustrates the potential for defining and building core knowledge capacity. As a company that designs and manufactures telecommunication systems, employees throughout the world generate core knowledge relating to customer solutions for their innovative customer solutions. Employees share their sales arguments, project summaries, presentations, business plans, and expertise around the world. The success of process reflects the connection between core business, the knowledge domain, and the building of employees' capabilities. Now, viewers, we have come to the ending of this session. Let's quickly review all the important points discussed in today's video. Knowledge management system provides efficient and effective system for capturing, recording, and disseminating knowledge. Clarification of core knowledge, core business knowledge domain, the existing and required capabilities of staff, and the success of process reflects the connection. Our quote of this session is from Hazrat Abu Bakr Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu, who said, "Without knowledge, action is useless, and knowledge without action is futile." This quotation clearly depicts that knowledge and actions both are important for a good and successful deed. In this video, I have elaborated the first phase of developing a core knowledge framework, that is clarifying the core knowledge scope. Inshallah, in my next video, I shall discuss the phase 2, that is to define the core knowledge parameters in detail. Hopefully, this video has added some new information into your knowledge. If you have understood the points, then please do share this knowledge to others so that the maximum of people can get useful knowledge. Thank you and stay blessed.